Welcome to Betty's Kitchen. Today we're making hummingbird cake. This is the cake that I have selected for Mother's Day. I wanted to give a nice cake for Mother's Day, and I think this probably is a good choice. It reminds me of carrot cake, but if you don't like carrots, or you don't like having to shred them, and also that cake has coconut, at least my version does, if you don't like shredded things like that, then you can get away from them with this cake, and we have a little bit different flavor because we're adding bananas to it. So let's get started. It's an easy cake. I think it's easier than the carrot cake. It does have a cream cheese frosting that I'll do in a separate upload. But we're going to start with a large mixing bowl. And what we're going to do is a lot of mixing. We're not going to have to beat anything other than 3 eggs to get started, and I've already done that. So we're going to go down here to the far end where I have my all-purpose flour. You can see it's just regular all-purpose flour. I need 3 cups of that. So that goes in the big bowl. And next, I'm going to need some sugar. So right here, I've measured out 2 cups of sugar. Each one of these is a cup. Put those in. And then since we used all-purpose flour instead of self-rising, we need to put some baking soda. I have 1 teaspoon of baking soda right here. And then we need to add some salt. I have 1 teaspoon of salt right here. And then for our spice, it's kind of like carrot cake, it has 1 teaspoon of ground cinnamon. Now I'm going to pause at this point and stir this around. Let me get this all blended and we'll be right back. I have my dry ingredients mixed together, and I think that's pretty well mixed. So we'll go on to some liquid ingredients. I mentioned the eggs. I have 3 well-beaten eggs. We're just going to pour those over the top and not stir them in yet because it would make a stiff dough, and you need more liquid than that for the amount of flour and spices. Now I'm going to do some vegetable oil. I'm just using a generic vegetable oil, but if you are very specific about the kind of oil you want to use, just substitute 1 cup of the kind of oil that you use for cakes. I know there's a lot of discussion about, oh, I don't use that oil, I use this oil. Use whatever you like. I'm using this today because it's convenient for me, and it's generally pleasing to most people, but obviously not everyone, but just use what you like and then you'll be happy. Now I have some vanilla extract, and I've measured out 1/2 tablespoon. That's the same as 1 1/2 teaspoons. That goes in. Next on my list is crushed pineapple. I have 8 ounces right here, and I'm going to put all of it in undrained. That's one reason this is so easy. Once you get your items measured and prepared, like the eggs beaten and the bananas chopped, things like this just go in so easily that it doesn't take you long to mix this together. Pecans, I've got some chopped pecans or pecan pieces. You need 1 cup. This is a very nutty cake. So if you don't like nuts, I guess you can make it without the nuts, but I would suggest that you just substitute if you don't like pecans. You could use walnuts, chopped walnuts, or you could use maybe some chopped almonds. Take slivered almonds and then put them in your chopper, and they need to be reasonably finely chopped. One more thing and then we'll stir. I have 2 bananas lying here to remind me that I used 2 bananas. They're getting a little dark, although I did give them a squirt of lemon juice because for me it takes a little while to set everything up. For you, you may not need it at all, but lemon juice generally keeps your fruits fresh looking. But this looks fine. In fact, these bananas were a little less ripe than I would like. I kind of would choose to use the bananas that are just getting to the point where you don't want to eat them as fresh bananas. You want to cook them. but mine were straight from the grocery store, so that meant that they had a little bit of green on the end, not much. So these are sort of medium ripe. Now we'll stir. Now this is going to take me a little time to get this all blended. You do not beat this. This is not anything that you beat. From the time I put down the mixer after beating my eggs, I was through beating. Everything else got stirred. Now you can see I have work to do here, but I want to explain to you that I have three prepared cake pans, all of the same size. And these are about 9 inches, 9.5 inches across. What I've done to prepare them is I've used butter on the bottom and the sides. Then I did put a piece of parchment paper down here. You can use wax paper if you like, but put something there if you want to be sure that you can get that out of the pan. One of the worst things that can happen with your cake is you can't get it out of the pan. Then if it's a layer cake, it's not going to have those nice layers. So I have used the parchment paper, and then on top of that I put more butter, and then I put flour, and I've shaken this around until you can see the flour is up on the edges and across the bottom. So all three are just the same. What I plan to do after this is mixed together, I will take equal amounts to each one until I have used all my batter, and I'll have three pans of cake mix that go in the oven. We put it in a 350 degree oven, and it will bake until I can put a toothpick in, and then when it comes out clean, I know the cake is done. So I'll let you know how long that is for this particular cake. Ovens vary, so it might be different for yours. But when we come back, I think our cake will be done. The cake layers look done to me, and it's been about 19 or 20 minutes. So it doesn't take all that long. Now I'm going to test these to make sure. So we go to the deepest point and use a clean toothpick. If it comes out clean like this, then it's done. So I'll be taking these out, and you'll see them over on the counter in just a second. Here are our three baked hummingbird cake layers, just straight out of the oven. So they're really fiery hot. What I want to do is let them cool in the pan for about 10 minutes, and then I need to take a knife and go around the edges and remove them from the pan. And I'll either put them on a cake rack to cool, or if you don't have that, you can just use a flat tray. If you have a flat tray or plate that this doesn't hang off the edges, it'll be fine. So we'll be taking care of cooling them, and then we can ice the cake. And then the very last step is going to be we decorate with pecans. This is just traditional hummingbird cake. So after you get this evenly spread, it doesn't have to have swirls or anything like that. You can put whatever design you like. Just try to get all of the brown of the cake covered. And then I have 1/2 cup of chopped pecans right here. And I think I'll take my hand because I can sprinkle it better. And if they go on the counter, I'm not going to worry about them. I can clean those up later. So you just want to have a fairly even spread of pecans on the top. And move those over a little bit, but not much, because they're probably already entrenched in the icing. So there we go. We have our hummingbird cake, and it's all finished. It just needs to go in the refrigerator and set up. Here is our completed hummingbird cake, and it is missing a piece because I have a piece that I cut out that I wanted to show you so that you could see the texture. If you haven't made one or eaten one somewhere, you probably wonder how those bananas come out in it and how the rest of it goes. So I have over here a fork, and I'm just going to go down this line right here and get a little bit. I really didn't get any icing. I should have gotten some icing, but we all know what cream cheese frosting tastes like. It's really good. I did get a lot of pecans, which were inside, and also we had some in the topping. It's nice and sweet and moist. What more can I say? It's a wonderful cake for you to have for Mother's Day or any time of the year.